Nacogdoches, welcome to our latest edition of Jack Talk. On today's show, our team took a trip north of town to check out some old-fashioned bluegrass music. Herbert Midgley comes in to discuss his latest feature film, and the heated subject of gun control hits home in downtown Nac. All that up next. Joining us today, I have Devonte Hill and Crystal. They recently took a trip to the Sandy Bluegrass Festival. Let's take a look at what they saw.
Well, the highway runs long shore across into space. I look into the rearview, I swear I can see your face.
Citizens of East Texas got a treat this last weekend at the Sandy Land Bluegrass Reunion. This event, put on twice a year by Cowboy and Sarah Barrett, gives fans of the genre a chance to come and listen to their favorite music in a close and intimate setting. Whether you're an older vet of bluegrass music or a young gun picking away at a banjo, there was definitely something for you at this festival.
Music is a way of life, I've heard Preacher Duncan say. But if music's all you've done in life, you've played your life away. Sweet melody so clear from that fiddle he held dear. I'll love those tunes forever and a day. From the stores and streets in town, all who heard would gather round when Preacher Duncan told how Jesus saves. How that fiddle moved their soul, true words you never told. As the crowd joined in to sing Amazing Grace, the fiddle sing, banjos ring.
Wow, man, the Bluegrass Festival, that looks like a lot of fun. Was that y'all's first time going out to a Bluegrass Festival?
It was our first time. It was definitely different. I think we were both kind of out of our element, but it was definitely enjoyable.
Okay, what about the music? Are you into bluegrass or?
Yeah, it's, I have a friend, because I played with somebody a couple of months back who played bluegrass. That was like his favorite kind of genre of music. It has an interesting feel to it. It's a lot of homey kind of emotions you get whenever you listen to it. Usually the people who sing in it have epic beards. So, I mean, it's like, I don't have an epic beard like that. So,
okay, nice. You got to meet Cowboy Barrett, right? Mm-hmm. He's the coordinator of the event. He seems like an interesting guy because he has a very interesting name. So how was it meeting him?
He has a nice dog. I remember we were out there just kind of enjoying things. Some random dog came out of nowhere and started just running around. And he sat next to the little table he was at, the switcherboard. And he was just like looking around and said, "Hey, Cowboy, pet my back." And he's like, "All right, cool, we do it."
That's awesome. Okay, as a musician myself, I enjoy going out to different festivals and just watching the musicians, learning from them. Do either of you guys play any instruments or anything like that?
Yeah. Well, I'm teaching myself how to play ukulele, but I don't think that really has anything to do with bluegrass. I know Devonte is a more skilled musician.
I think ukulele, that's really awesome. String instruments, I think you can learn so many things from watching people at bluegrass, because I've actually been to one myself. What do you play?
I play electric guitar, acoustic, and I also have a baritone ukulele. So, I mean, I like to keep my options broad so I can play with different people in different styles. So bluegrass, I don't have a resonator guitar, because that's usually what's played in those types of music. Mm-hmm. But I know a friend who does. It has a really rich sound to it, especially if you use one of the sliders, which kind of looks like that little tube thing. That's what a slider is, yeah. So you just kind of use that and kind of
get that. Helps with bar chords, right?
Exactly.
Yes, mm-hmm. The struggle. But man, I'm sitting here with two really awesome people playing instruments mm-hmm. and everything. That's really cool. Was there anything at the festival other than music? Was it just music?
Yeah, there was a lot of shops and things that Cowboy and his partner, I guess, that lives there, Andy, well, they call him Bull, they built these themselves, and they were really interesting, very historic. They had a lot of antiques and like historical artifacts, and it was really neat to like go in there. I felt like I was in an American Pickers episode, because it definitely had that feel.
They also had wild animals. Because I remember Bull took me back to some kind of remote area. It was kind of sketchy at first, but they had donkeys and like they had a buffalo, and it's like, yeah, usually the kids come and they pet the animals. It was really interesting.
Okay, so they had stores, music. What about food? At festivals, you have to have food. Okay, I didn't stress on
that. Yes. Okay, so like we went in there, we're sitting at the table, and then Crystal's like, hey, my friend said these hamburgers are really good. You should try them. I was like, I don't know. It's $4. It's kind of expensive. He's like, no, you need to go here and try them, right? So we go over there, and like they hand make them. Like, so while you're asking what you want, they're like making the patties and everything. It's like all homemade, and like when you take your first bite into that hamburger, it's like a grease feeling. It's not like a greasy good. It's a really good greasy feeling. Like you like melt in your mouth, and it's so delicious. Unfortunately, I didn't have two. You know, so I can only enjoy one. So that's, maybe I almost cry, but it's okay. I'm a love.
Maybe next time if they have that event again. Is this something, the Bluegrass Festival, something you guys would go back to?
I would definitely go back. I mean, it was different, but it was really, I mean, we had a blast together. It was a lot of fun just getting to know these people and like filming and listening to the music. It was just really great. And you know, the hamburger was
delicious.
Glorious. I mean, so I would definitely go back.
Dang, it sounds like I missed out and so did everyone else. Up next, gun rights are one of the most heated subjects to talk about in the United States right now. We have Devonte Hill to clarify what exactly some of those issues are. Hello, Devonte.
How you doing?
How are you doing?
I'm good.
I'm good. All right. Can you just tell me what gun control is?
Well, gun control is an umbrella term. It's a lot of things, it's not just one thing. It's basically, it covers any kind of law that prohibits the use of certain types of guns, to background checks, to mandating the use of having gun locks. You know, all guns are issued to have a gun lock on it before it can be sold. So that's all of that is under the term gun control.
Okay, and why is it such a heated topic right now?
The three main arguments that are out right now, or kind of the opinions of the day. Gun control is kind of like a thing that infringes on rights and pretty much like self-defense, you know? So people are like, you know, I don't want this because, you know, this is my Second Amendment right to do this, right? So that's one of the, you know, the standings. The one of the other standings is that the view of having limited ability, like availability of guns would lead to a safer, less crime society. So that's, some people believe that, you know, some people believe that, oh, you know, if we had some kind of form of gun control, you know, a lot of this mass murdering kind of stuff wouldn't happen. And also the third one is that we really need to focus more on mental illness and treatments, because most of the murders the mass murders that we have are from people who have been mentally ill and didn't have the right treatment for it. So those are kind of like the three main ones. Now, there was a study done by some hospitals and some medical centers in New York, and they studied 27 developed countries similar to the United States, like the UK, France, places like that. So these are not like undeveloped. And basically, they kind of wanted to look at those three arguments. They kind of wanted to look at, okay, so what is the correlation between gun ownership per capita head and just gun violence and deaths related from firearms? And so they found a direct correlation. Japan has the lowest number of owners of guns, and they also have the lowest deaths due to firearms. United States happens to be the one with the highest number of gun owners, and the highest number of firearm deaths. So they said a correlation. They didn't say that there was a cause, and it's not a causation, it's just a correlation between the two. The only country that had a difference between that was South Africa, because they had a lower than expected gun ownership rate, and they had a high number of, well, not high, but just higher than expected deaths by firearms. So those are some of the things to kind of look at.
Are gun laws in place right now helping limit gun-related crimes?
Well, as of right now, there is no laws that are being enforced. Because if you look at traffic violence and like the traffic accidents and deaths through the traffic accidents and things like that, we have a set number of things that to kind of limit that. We have campaigns from our government, like no texting while driving. You get jailed if you get caught, you know, drinking under the influence of alcohol, driving under the influence of alcohol. We also give out citations for traffic violations. So all this stuff had an effect of limiting the amount of people who died from traffic accidents. We don't have any kind of effort kind of drawn towards limiting the amount of deaths due to guns or things like that, any kind of gun control. We have gun control laws in certain states, but they're not being enforced. I mean, a law is useless if it's not being enforced. You know, so this is kind of one of the factors that we have here in this country. So.
Okay, what is Texas's stand on gun control compared to the rest of the U.S.?
Well, Texas is more of a conservative state. And their views are kind of, you know, we want to keep our guns. We don't want someone infringing on our rights. There was a study made by the Cato Institute, one of the conservative websites that I went on to, that said that 60% of criminals wouldn't attack a victim if they knew that that victim had a gun on them. Now, I'm not sure if that's true or not. This the Cato Institute is funded by individuals, not by the government. So there's no tie. I don't know if, you know, there's factual or not, but that's just some of the things. It's kind of more of a fear-driven type entity, but that's more of Texas's view.
Okay. There was actually a gun rally in Nacogdoches this past weekend, right? And you were able to check it out. Let's go ahead and take a look at that. Your findings, what can you tell our viewers about all the gun control issues?
Yeah, well, through all my research that I've done, pretty much most of the proposed gun laws or propositions that are being made right now, they're not affecting handguns. Most of them are aimed towards like high-powered guns, semi-automatic guns, things that could cause mass destruction. So the people who make the argument about, you know, gun control is going to take away my guns, if you have a handgun, that you can use a handgun for self-defense. That's not classified as a weapon of mass destruction, I guess. So the proposed gun laws that are out right now wouldn't affect that. Another thing that I've kind of noticed was the fact that we really, as a country, need to sit down and have a discussion about this. You know, we need to kind of set aside our emotions, you know, and kind of our rage about certain things, and just really kind of sit down and say, okay, what is the problem, and how can we fix it? If we have a legit conversation about it, maybe we can get something done. I mean, now, our history has proven that we can't do that. I mean, we still haven't had racial relation questions. We haven't had questions about abortion. And we just can't talk to each other. But if we can do that, that'd be good.
All right. Yeah. Well, that's all we have for you today here on Jack Talk. Thank y'all for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.